Yeah, okay. So, opinion, it was much bigger than I was expecting, and I was thinking in a conference like this before. I thought it was just like one, I'm not sure, of people. Yeah, big, like, it's about 500 speakers, 10 stages in parallel. So, there's several things on that you're interested in. But they are all on YouTube, so if you want to watch that, I think a lot of the talks are on there. So yeah, about 10 stages, but about 20 different zones, all across King's Cross area, so it's spread over quite an area of London. So they had showcases, different companies, IBM, Cisco, different places. Set up talks, there was a big keynote and opening, Mayor of London, and yeah, I only found out about this because Chris posted the link and so it's interesting. It was something like there's a few hundred for like just a two topic parts or something, and the full conference was about £2,000 full ticket. So I thought I'd try my luck and ask if I could volunteer to see what they come back with. Just to see what the options were. It said I got an email back. You have agreed to volunteer on these days. I'm all signed up, and so I kind of went with it. And I think the deal was that you'd get full access if you do sort of a couple of hours each of 3 days volunteering. And I thought that might be good for me as well, just because it forces me to engage and meet people and so on. But I got lucky really and went up there, and they had so many staff, so many volunteers, they basically just asked, what was it you wanted to get out of volunteering? What did you volunteer? And some people were doing it as part of the course and so on. And I said, really, I just went to see the talks. And so they were completely flexible. And really, I just had to go around the conference with a t-shirt that got me full access. So it worked out pretty well. And I did a bit of scanning people's tickets into some of the events, but I got to choose the stages and the talks. So I just scanned people and sit down and watch the talks. And yeah, there's quite a few sort of big names and interesting things that I've just only really read about. I hadn't really met people that DeepMind had a showcase up there. There was Google's X Moonshot factory. These people were just get to play with the latest technologies and work on big world-changing
X Moonshot projects. Factory.
Yeah, so this, they only work on projects that they think will change the world, but they're moonshots in that. They're very high risk, so usually in industry, if a project's very high risk, it doesn't get done. You're not going to put a lot of money into something that's not likely to get an outcome. But if everyone took that approach, then the really big things, the moon landings and so on, would never have happened. And so this space is just set up just to put resources into these really big high bets. There's the Alan Turing Institute. Stage there, and they had a lot of talks about security, but I know they do a lot more. I think it's a university, but it's also a collaboration between a lot of different institutions. There's NHS X, which were there and I didn't know much about, and this is part of the new digital strategy for the company, and particularly the NHS. And they're trying to open things up a bit more, make things move a lot faster when they've got old systems. And I think they've tried and failed a lot of times to open up data on the NHS. It's a very difficult thing to do in terms of policy and privacy and so on. It looks like they're actually finally doing something, and some of the people I've talked to at the NHSX, some of the things they're talking about are things like you have an NHS login, sort of single sign-in, but you could also third-party app developers can use this as well, and then like when you're using your Google account, your Facebook account, you can choose to give third-party access to your NHS data if you want to share it with us. So this is about making an ecosystem.
A bit like the Open Banking Initiative.
Yeah, and it sounds very open. It only started in February. It's a lot of it's in the policy stages, talking about this stuff. I noticed their web, it's very opening that, even their website is on GitHub. We looked at that, it's made with Node, Babel, and templating engines and something. It looks very nice, and it's all designed to be accessible and scalable and a modern open source project. So there's likely to be opportunities there as they open up their APIs and things that we do with that. It's another thing that we'll be integrating with. The other problem that they're trying to solve is there's a lot of apps out there for brain training and all kinds of different things, and people don't know what's based on legitimate research and what isn't, what's recommended by the NHS and what isn't.
Does that matter?
I think...
I'm kind of thinking that NHS X is on a beat into hell on that one. People have sold snake oil for tens of thousands of years and will go on selling snake oil.
Yeah, well, I think they're thinking that it could be another label. Some people say, oh, this is NHS, therefore it's good, or therefore it's 10 years out of date, whatever that label's going to mean. Let's talk on something called PyMC3. Has anyone heard of that? So this is just a library that's for machine learning, but in particular probabilistic data structures, raising statistical modeling and probabilistic machine learning. So if anyone's interested in that, have a look at PyMC3. There's a talk by a guy that runs a website called Papers with Code, which is very popular, and it's a sort of Reddit style aggregate of all the latest papers on artificial intelligence, machine learning, that come with open source code. And so it's sort of ranked by the number of GitHub stars and the number of people that have been able to re-implement the paper. And so you can see what's trending, what the latest categories and things people work on in academia. But it's good to have all the papers actually have some code with them that you can re-implement.
It was useful when checking somebody's work is not to use their code. From an academic perspective,
yeah,
it's better to re-implement it, because if you can't re-implement it, you know something wrong with it.
Something's wrong. Exactly. And so they've created a community there. There's a Slack channel. It's quite popular. And
this is for the academic papers.
Mm. And you can also submit your results for if you have a go, and you can see what training results, what scores you got. And so there's also common data sets that people use for testing, sort of a litmus test for testing the latest algorithm to see if it's improved on it. And there are tables there with the latest results for different things, and you can say what results you got. You can also, sometimes people will write a paper and it's quite difficult to implement it. Even when they do put code out there, it's partial. And so you can post your own implementations of the things. And so it's a good way of bringing everything together. Lots of people working on the same thing.
Yes. Particularly sharing the data sets. When we were writing evolutionary algorithms, there wasn't a whole lot of data. Until you got into operations research, which is a business function. They wouldn't go on in universities. They've been testing the different approaches to optimization algorithms on standard data sets with published league tables for who has done this in the fastest time and so on. What a difference that made to running, you know, why didn't the evolutionary algorithm people know about this brilliant resource and putting it together with the academic papers is
I think it would be interesting to see how this stuff gets organised in the future as well. There was a stage called the impact stage, which was just looking at the impact of artificial intelligence on industry, government, and society. Just those talks on that, those topics. I found out there's an office for artificial intelligence in government now. New office has opened up, so I think they're taking it seriously and they're looking at how, you know, I think the numbers I was heard was something like 50% of jobs or people have to be reskilled. So I think no one really knows what's going to happen, but they're preparing because they think it's going to have quite a big impact on a lot of different sectors. Talking about what they're doing in other countries, in Finland, they've just put out free artificial intelligence courses for everyone, so anyone can do it.
What does that mean then, a course?
Yeah, a course on artificial intelligence. I don't know what that entails, but
I think the thought is that people are going to be working with these technologies in their jobs. Their jobs are either going to be redundant and they're going
to
move into this.
They don't need to know about algorithms.
No, I raised this. I said that if you learn what it's about now, it's going to be, even that's going to be, you have to retrain again.
So the majority of people in Finland might need to know how not to be rude to the light switch.
Exactly. I'll be very interested to know what's in these courses.
Yeah.
Another impact I'll talk about is this, the amount of continuous data that everything's getting now. There's a limit to how normal calculus-based systems and what they can actually do on stuff. I think that's what Chris was talking about, probabilistic kind of data and so on, that can do things much faster or deal with much bigger data sets in real time. So there's a move towards that. There's also a company that's quite interesting that was working on creating a system where you can, if you're a company and you've got a valuable data set, you can make machine learning sort of APIs available on that so that people can use your data without you having to give away your IP or the actual data set itself. So the idea is there's a lot of pharmaceutical companies, there's a lot of companies out there that have got masses of data that would benefit everyone if we could all just work on it, but they've got a lot of IP attached. So they're coming up with ways where people can use their machine learning problems, or you can test your own machine learning algorithms, or test your own code on other people's data sets without them having to give away their IP or give away the data sets. You kind of, you run something on it, you get back the results at a higher level. So yeah, that's quite interesting. And there's the cutting edge stage. Jane Wang, from senior research scientist from DeepMind, and she gave an interesting talk about abstract and causal reasoning. So this is another sort of network-based artificial intelligence problem where it's about considering the implications of your actions, where you might do one thing that's going to have a knock-on effect. What's the knock-on effect of that? What is it that caused this to happen? So it's a bit like this imagination thing where you're predicting what's going to happen, what the outcome of your actions is going to be. And the way they're doing this is with causal network diagrams. So there, and it's called structured learning with prior examples. So if you've learned from the past, different structures will have different results, and how this speeds up learning. So if you're maybe with Chris's Space Invaders game, it's going to have to learn from pixel level, from scratch, how to play this game. Whereas if I sat down in front of Space Invaders, I would kind of recognise there's a thing at the bottom and guess that I can move left and right. And I would see that these are aliens and that I should probably be shooting at them. Because I've already got these abstract ideas from learning about other games and other things. And so having sort of prior examples of things can speed up your learning. And she was really looking at, she had moved from neuroscience into artificial intelligence, and so she had got a lot of information about how children had learned things, and she was mentioning that two-year-olds can spot a causal relationship but doesn't have the ability to intervene. And so the idea here is that you've got these networks and you've got things, you've got unknowns, and when you've got an unknown, that should spark your curiosity. In order to test things and learn from it, you then have to probe it. It's like having a hypothesis in science. You know, what happens if I change that? Now let's see what happens and see what I can learn from it. So where there are unknowns, just tamper with things and see what you can learn. And these are where you're making targeted interventions in a system in order to learn what that intervention, what effect it has. So you can learn more causal relationships. And so it's interesting that a two-year-old can actually spot the causal relationship, but it doesn't have the ability to make a targeted intervention in order to learn more about it. However, a four-year-old can then make targeted interventions in order to work out what things are going on. And in some tests, I guess they were tailored just for testing this particular thing, they were actually able to make targeted interventions better than adults, because adults had more bias because they had more stronger existing priors and learned knowledge. A teenager, however, can make the most complex strategies for figuring things out in this way. And again, so adults have more associative bias. So you've learned these existing priors over time, and you're going to be lazy and take the shortcut of using those.
Isn't there a strong argument that being an adult means that you've learned enough priors not to have to think about things? That
yeah.
The measure for having succeeded in growing up is not being at risk of doing all of these random experiments.
Yeah, you've got a lot more.
Lion in the nose, would it bite me?
You've got a lot more experience, and so this is much better, except at an algorithmic level, you can bring this up and you can make a test where the teenager will succeed and the adult will fail, because it's your existing priors will weigh you down. So if you've written something to exploit that, then an adult's more likely to fail at the task than a child is. So yeah, this is a cutting edge stage, and then I had a look at the health stage, which is looking at the effect of artificial intelligence and latest technologies on healthcare. And this was quite eye-opening. I didn't realise there's so much going on here. One thing is in biotechnology, computer science is really running with it. So if you traditional biologists have learnt from your textbooks, there's only so much you can do, because biology is so complex. You quickly run out of words for things, whereas artificial intelligence can find really deep causal relationships and so on. And they're saying that there needs to be more retraining there in computer science for biologists, and if you're in computer science, then it's worth looking at biotech, because this is really exploding in what they're able to do. And these are the sort of things that they're using to solve problems in climate change and environmental science and so on. Yeah, that was quite interesting. I had a talk from someone called Mary Lou Jepson, and she was a former executive at Google and Facebook, and co-founder of that One Laptop Per Child project. And it just sounds like a bit of a genius, got 200 patents. And she had
one bowl of food.
Yeah, why did they want that? To
yeah.
It was a smartphone now, anyway.
Yeah.
yeah, and so she had a brain tumor. I hear the story of a lot of people that have gone on to really change things in healthcare. They've experienced it firsthand.
Mm-hmm.
And they nearly missed this, because MRI is not everywhere. It's very expensive, long waiting times, and it's not scalable. You can't make MRI any cheaper. It uses superconductive cooling and all kinds of things. And so she's founded this company called Openwater, and they're working on medical imaging using focused ultrasound and infrared or red light. And this is really interesting. I didn't realize red light can actually go through skull, for instance. So you can it's completely non-invasive technology, and what it does is when you shine red light through something, you get at the small scale, you get diffraction and scattering, and so you can't see a past a certain point because of that. And they thought that this diffraction scattering is pretty much random lasers and so on, but it turns out that it's really not, and that with machine learning you can decipher this, and you get a slight shift in colours, which you can then resolve to 3D structure, and you can get a better resolution with this focus ultrasound and red to infrared light that's better than MRI, and it's completely non-invasive and it's cheap. And they've got these things down to the size of a Coke can already. Well, I expect it will be the size of a sticker that you put on your forehead one day. But some of the videos that they were showing were really scary, where they were resolving thoughts to text. They trained a lot of students with hours and hours of watching YouTube videos, and then they got them to imagine one of the videos afterwards without watching it, and they were able to get a low resolution version of this that you could recognise that it was that video just from the brain activity. So what they can do if they scale this up to a higher resolution would be very interesting. And Bradley raised an interesting point. It's people learn in different ways, and not everyone can visualise. I don't feel like I can visualise things that well.
And I think this is a massive advantage when it comes to understanding things which just aren't visual. So many dimensional spaces, visualisation working through. So it's interesting to wonder.
Yeah.
So they were able to train one person and then understand by looking at my hand on that brain of one person while they watched the videos.
Yeah, and resolve which video.
Because presumably that doesn't follow to the next person whose neural structure could be quite different.
Yeah.
Or not. But that's an interesting point. How similar are the way you imagine things to the way I imagine things?
Mm.
And how dissimilar?
So this the decoding of interference patterns is a field called holography. Just look into it. And they're also saying that, I wasn't quite sure what the figure they said, it was 3-12% of cancers are actually caused by the imaging of MRIs and scans and radiology and so on. And so there's another reason why it might be good to get these cheap alternatives. And you can't have MRI scanners all across Africa and real countries either. So even the early projects, I think, looking to be very useful. There's another talk at the health stage as well by the Headspace co-founders for the meditation app. And they were talking very much about mental health and how it used to be like this complete black box, and that they had a hope for machine learning and that neuroscience and so on could actually help people here. And they were saying, you know, we've got this thing called mental health, and people need to realise that, look after it. We spend a few minutes every day looking after our teeth. Why don't we spend a few minutes looking after our minds? So it's very big on things like meditation.
Yes. It's worth pointing out when they're talking about technology suddenly working and that mental health was a black box.
Yeah.
This just simply isn't true. For
no, I realise
that. People for tens of thousands of years, this has been daily practice.
But I guess, and they had psychology, and there's a lot of things into it, right?
Crudely and slowly in the last couple of hundred years started catching up with stuff that we've known for tens of thousands of years.
Yeah. So the Headspace co-founder, they're talking about, I think they've now got signed off medically, this thing where they use voice and you can talk. It's a bit like a chatbot. You talk with the app, which is something they want to bring into the Headspace app, where you can actually have a mindful conversation with it, or maybe you will tell it something about you and it will direct questions back to get you to explain. So it's going to be a bit like your psychologist. I was very, very skeptical of whether I'd want to talk to my phone or how useful that can be, and I'm still very skeptical, but they said that the results were very good.
People spend a lot of money going and talking to a shrink because they don't know them. And so similarly, talking to something like a phone.
Yeah, that's one of the things they mentioned. They said that people were a lot more open with it than they were
with a human being.
With a human being.
There's less shame. You know the machine isn't judging you.
Yeah.
So it's similar to going and seeing a shrink. Here's somebody you pay not to have an attitude. And so it's safer to be far more honest with them than you would with a friend. When people say, oh, why don't you just go to the pub and have a drink with your friends and let it all hang out? You don't do that because of our shame. And so, but that AI was written in the 1950s.
I remember chatbots where you can type and talk to it and it will come back giving you a question and say, yeah. And there's another stage, also on the health stage actually, there's talks about 100-year life and the problem of people getting much older. And there was a mixture here. One was dealing with these older people and making life better for you, but also talks from these billionaires that are actually trying to reach the escape velocity of the length of your life. Live long enough. And technology will be better, you're going to live even longer. and just these people that want to live forever. And so there was a lot of talks on longevity research, stem cell research, and some of the people that have been the first to actually undergo genetic therapy of the same sort of thing that they've done in mice, where they live twice as long and so on. So this stuff's all very interesting, but raises a hell of a lot of ethical questions, so I don't know what's going to happen there.
Presumably they were looking for good packing algorithms to store it all the way somewhere as well.
Yeah, there was a talk by Camilla Cavendish, which was David Cameron's head of policy, that brought in the sugar tax. Was saying that, you know, people eat too much sugar, it's not healthy for you, it would be better for everyone in general if we put in this tax. And she's fighting for the effects of aging to be recognised as a disease, and because at the moment I don't think you're allowed to prescribe things that just fight the natural aging process.
She wants to be able to call age a disease. A frightening lady.
Yeah, very scary stuff. But on some of the lighter things that seem a bit more reasonable, where they were looking at how tech can help old people. I thought that this might be a bit like how tech can help the homeless, which I thought about, and it turns out maybe it just can't that much. But there were some interesting practical ideas. So one was someone who developed an auction program, it's like on TV, but it's interactive. And so by standing up, you can place a bid. And so in old people's home or something, it's something that they can. It's a simple task, but actually just standing up to bid and sitting down again a few times actually gives you a bit more activity. And just sitting in the chair the whole time. So it was about how to use AI to make these sort of interactive games older people could get involved with. That's pretty much it. I think my opinion was that I was very much expecting there to be a few interesting things, and then a few things where it's just people talking about themselves, helping their own career, or big companies saying, linking the words AI with everything they do, and being a lot of hot air. But I think perhaps I would go as far as saying that artificial intelligence is actually underhyped, just because some of the high impact stuff really is looking like it might have a really big impact. But yeah, still a mixture. There's still a lot of stuff where they're doing very clever stuff, but it's not really meeting real people where they're at. So I don't think people are going to engage with it somehow.
Was there any more philosophical panel?
There was an ethics stage.
Ethics or should or should not work on.
Yeah, there was an ethics stage, and I missed a lot of that. I went to the other stages.
So we know where you're staying.
Yeah,
on the
cutting edge. Yeah, I went for the cutting edge stuff. But yeah, there was a lot of talks on the ethics, particularly on the future of learning and future of work. And the answer is they don't know what's going to happen and who it's going to happen. Yeah.
Since the first significant changes to the way we got by it. We've never known what was going to come and what kind of dramatic impact this would have on.
But the fact that they're bringing out things like the NHS X and the Department for Artificial Intelligence as a sectoral government and so on means that they do seem to be taking this stuff seriously.
What's interesting with the NHS X, the first thing you noticed was the fact that they had a website on GitHub. It strikes me as that's something that's almost standard. And
yeah, I know a lot of the government
so
websites.
Like, oh, but have they actually achieved absolutely nothing? You know, created a fancy
a lot of the websites
to obscure that fact.
The achievement is that they're catching up with everybody
but,
else.
But I think the trend was,
website using
the trend was about opening up
HTML.
Yeah.
The trend was about opening up the data and opening up the APIs that let you access those data. And I think that's what the discussion is largely about, how open data might be.
Well, see, the challenge there, though, that they want me to open my data. So making an available API for me to use other people's health data is no bloody good at all if people take the attitude whereby their health data is not something they're prepared to share. That's why the last initiative.
I think as long as the NHS has your data anyway, and they can do stuff internally on that. About opening
the obvious situation is my doctor has my data. The NHS doesn't. Mm. And when I go to a different doctor, he hasn't got the first fucking idea who I am or what's wrong. Same with hospitals and that.
Yeah.
So even internally, they're not very good at sharing this data.
Mm. I think the NHS need to share the data more. I don't think they care too much whether you individually.
Last time we got to the point in law, it was gunned down because people don't want to share that data. The feeling is that the fact that I have lung damage will put my insurance premiums up,
mm.
and I won't be able to get insurance. This is certainly the case in America, and people here fear the misuse rather than see the advantage.
Yeah,
of sharing
I think
data.
It's I think it's kind of without saying it, their way of bringing in a bit more capitalism and. So they can benefit from industry and competition and different people producing apps that you can then choose who you go to
mm.
to get your data analysed by and so on, what apps you use. I think the NHS are too slow to bring in things like that.
Yeah.
And so they're falling
yes.
behind, where in
the
US they've got the competition.
The advantage of sharing my health data to me is what will make me share my health data. So if I can have an app,
exactly.
And I'm more likely. Over this vitality initiative, now my insurance company knows where I am 24 hours a day, don't they?
Yeah.
I'm doing and how fast my heart is beating.
Yeah, so I think
but
it's
they
about
did that by giving me fancy toys to play with.
I think it's about opening this stuff up to the private sector, but without them using that language, they can't say, right, we're going to start privatising some of these things. They have to say, we're going to make this stuff more open source and open up our APIs and make it more of a community and collaborative thing, and they're going to have to you can use that kind of language so that it doesn't get shut down.
Different language. Yeah. As soon as there's something in it for me in sharing my health data, I'll share it, won't I? You know, we share it with Google for advertising purposes. Why the hell wouldn't we share it personal data in order to live healthier life?
Well, anyway, Bradley, I'll stop.
Yeah, I was just thinking, people are too stupid to be able to have access to their data to sort of to share it with, aren't they? People are quickly going to share it with
them. One of those sets of arguments, and if you look over your own health data and have a look at one or two articles on Google, you're going to be in accident and emergency 24/7 with massive paranoia.
Also, I was thinking the other way. How long is it going to be before someone creates a, you know, clickbaity quiz and just share all your health data, and you can play this Facebook quiz and
right.
share
yeah.
all their data with someone
yeah.
who really, really,
yeah.
really shouldn't
yeah.
have your data.
People will, won't
they? People will.
That may not be a bad thing.
I'll throw all mine out then. Have it all.
I said this to my doctor.
Learn from
give
it.
Give me my data and I'll publish it on my own website.
Learn from it. Bring
yeah.
in the new
yeah.
technologies so that I don't die of them later on.
My dog had to point out that he can't give me my health data.
Could
share it amongst other people in private companies, but he can't let me have it.
I came across another sort of ethical question with health data recently. Finally, because tests are becoming so much cheaper to do all sorts of tests, including DNA tests,
mm-hmm.
they've increasingly called this data, and they found that when they do tests of DNA tests of different people in a single family, they're finding people's parents aren't who they think they are, and something
yeah.
incredible, like 10% of cases. And,
well, yeah.
and they're saying, they're now thinking, do we tell people if your dad's not your dad? Should we?
Yeah, if you're a nurse or something and you realise that someone's parents isn't who they think they is, I think the policy is that you don't tell them.
That would be quite right.
Yeah, but it's a funny one, isn't it?
Yeah,
so it's not going to stay hidden very long if everyone just shares their data with everyone.
23andMe, I've got my genome.
That we have been long stroke forward about these sorts of things, because it's not a new feature. We've been doing this for thousands of years. And isn't there, I read an interesting article about us looking like our dads, regardless of who our dad is, that there is a, there's a strong survival, increase in survival probability if you look and behave like the bloke who is nearest to your mum during your formative years.
That's right, it's facial expression and so on.
Yes, yes.
People look like their pets, I don't know how that happens.
Well, people pick pets, don't they? But it's, yeah, it's very interesting the way dogs and people look the same.
I think it's largely you expect people to look like their parents, as you say they do, you think they do. There's no logic there, is there? It's just you're putting two features together.
There are behavioural ticks that you can learn. But that cooing and ooh, doesn't he look like you? And he looks like Winston Churchill in those first couple of days of birth. They all look the same. How can they look like their parents? But that's the first comment we make, isn't it?
Yeah.
Oh, doesn't he look like you? In this one, it belongs to that person over there. Really good.